So, yes, I am Joe Orengo, your host and the president of XR Nation, which is a business ecosystem for the industry in the Nordic and Baltic regions. I'm also the co-organizer of Nite Helsinki, which was established to help further advance the XR industry in the Helsinki capital region by bringing together and empowering its community. Nite Helsinki is part of Augmented World Expo, the world's number one XR series, event series, which has a reach of over 250,000 professionals dedicated to the adoption and growth of extended reality as the next wave of computing. AWE produces conferences in the US, Europe, Asia, and Tel Aviv, and hosts AWE Night meetups from Tokyo to Toronto, from Berlin to San Francisco, and from Tel Aviv to Helsinki, and many more in between. So if you're interested in taking part as a sponsor, presenter, volunteer, and so on, please visit our meetup page. We have a link to sign up there. All right, now I can share. Well, I don't have to share any screens right now because that's going to mess me up. So I'll just briefly go through the agenda, and then we can take it from there. So first up, we have spatial news. Then we'll have a presentation on augmenting IoT. We'll have a very interesting guided meditation session, and we'll have a Varjo demo, and then we'll end off with some announcements. And today I would like to especially thank our sponsors, Arilin, Glue, and Grib. And they were our sponsors last time as well. We really appreciate their support. Okay, so now I'm going to show a brief slide to introduce our first presenter. I'll just introduce him because I know him already, and he's there in the gallery. Demu Ollilainen. He is the Prime Minister of XR Nation and the co-founder, and he is going to be sharing with us the latest episode edition of Spatial News. Demu, please take it away.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Yeah, I have the latest edition of Spatial News. I'm not going to read them out loud here. I created again a video, which is being shared hopefully quite soon. It's maybe not as good as the first one, but it's there anyway. And for the duration of the video, keep your hands inside the cart at all times and don't scream too much. Let's see how this works. I shall play it and I will mute myself for that duration.
Hello and welcome to Spatial News. This is a newscast for AWEnight Helsinki, but it can be watched outside of AWEnight as well. Tonight in the news is from Facebook Connect, the announcement of Oculus Quest 2 with the Snapdragon XR2 chipset has been announced that it will be available in October the 13th, actually, with the price tag of $299. So that is something that we are all looking forward quite a lot. On that front, there has been quite a lot of news regarding the smart glass, let's say, segment that Facebook is revealing their smart glass headset in 2021. And that will be called or it will be under the Ray-Ban brand. And also Apple has announced that their smart glasses are also being released in 2021. So next year, we are looking for a lot of smart glasses and a lot of AR content, I hope. But that's for the quick news. Now we have our story from Kalle 3 regarding Mario Kart. I don't know what he has been doing these days, but Take it away, Kalle 3.
Yes, yes, thank you, Teemu. Yes, yes, I am here in the Mario Kart world. As you can see, the cars are driving here. This is like my living room. The cars are going there. They are real cars, you know, physical. Oh, I almost dropped the mic. They are real cars. They are physical cars, small ones. And I drive them with my you know, the what is it? What do you call it? What do you call it where you drive it? But anyway, you control the cars and they are in the augmented reality. You can add stuff there and you are like driving there in your home. So it is quite fun. I think I'll have one of these for me as well. These are quite nice, as you can see the cars are going there. Yes, yes, it is very good. Back to you, Teemu.
Thank you, Kalle. That was quite an interesting report regarding Mario Kart. I think I'll have to grab a Nintendo Switch myself as well. Looks very, very nice. Now on with the next story. We have a story regarding Eurosport bringing their sport coverages to the new era regarding a sort of a mixed reality cube or something like that. But we have our special reporter Kalle on site as well. So maybe Kalle, you can tell us a bit about that more, what it is, what it can do. Go ahead, Kalle.
Thank you, Teemu, for that introduction. But as you can see, I'm now in the Eurosport studio, and you can see that they can bring in the actual interviewee using virtual reality, or in this case, augmented reality, to the studio, which is good in these corona times because you don't have to bring nobody in the actual studio, but you can bring in anyone from anywhere to the studio to be interviewed. That is very cool technique. But, you know what? It has been already done in Finland, like 2 years ago. Check this out. It's in ice hockey. They are interviewing the ice hockey player. And that was like 2019, 2018, something like that. So, you know, the news is new, but it has already been done. So, back to you, Tim.
All right. Thank you, Kalle. Like you can see, in Finland, we do these things a bit beforehand the rest of the world. But on the other news, we have another reporter on top of our Kalles. We have a flying reporter, Joe, that has been going around in Helsinki. He visited Helsinki Games Capital in Arcade 5, located in Mario 1. And he met the Helsinki Games Capital's head, Managing Director, Mr. Gabriel Aimone. I don't know what they have been talking about, but let's take the insert from there. Go ahead, Joe.
And we're here with Gabriele Aimone, who is the Managing Director of Helsinki Games Capital.
Yesterday, yes, it was the first anniversary of Helsinki Games Capital, which is an association that was founded a year ago by 15 founding members, which are private companies, gaming companies, and the city of Helsinki. What we do is we take care of the gaming community in the capital region, and we try to help every startup that is popping up. And we have a huge event space, and we use it to run a lot of events, seminars, workshops that are useful for the gaming industry.
Then you had the very first All Night Helsinki here this past March. I'd like to know, what are your goals for the future for XR here at Arcade 5?
All Night, I think it was a massive success, so very well done. I think XR should be talked a lot more and discussed a lot more within the gaming community.
Thanks, Joe. That was an interesting interview with Gabriel. Next up, the Finnish smart glass company called Varjo. We last time said that they would be doing quite nice things with their headset regarding meetings. So we decided to visit their headquarters and see what's up and what they are doing there. And this time again, we have our flying reporter Joe on site interviewing Varjo's CMO Jussi Mäkinen. Take it away, Joe.
We're now entering the Shadow Realm.
The the iconic Varjo headset.
I'm here with CMO Jussi Mäkinen.
Okay, so we are here at Varjo's Experience Center, so come on and let's check out the green room. The green room is our chroma key room, so here we can do full chroma keying. And we can then combine that with physical elements. Like in here, we have our patient X, and we are doing quite exciting research and medical mixed reality simulations together with our partners.
Yes, look like she's gonna make it.
Thank you, Joe, for that interesting visit to the Varjo headquarters. We will be looking forward to seeing a lot of more news from Varjo, like their astronaut program is something we want to hear more about as it continues. Now on with the short topics. The Nordic VR Forum is going to be organized as a hybrid event, so it will be a physical as well as virtual event, and it will be held from the 28th to the 30th of October in Hanmar, Norway. Then a new partnership between Vrin and XR for All, a partnership that has been contracted for advancement of the European XR industry. The objective of this partnership is to facilitate mutual exchange of information on activities carried out by both organizations, and development of joint activities is also encouraged. I read it from there because I wouldn't have remembered to say it out loud. But that's the summary on the Vrin and XR for All cooperation. Then news from a gaming company called Punu Games. They have had a vote on their new mascot on Twitter, and it has been revealed. The new mascot name is Lieke. What is it connected to? They have developed a new game called Fantastic Energy, which is a location-based AR game focusing on energy efficiency and reducing players' carbon footprint. So if you are interested in that kind of stuff, go to punugames.com and read more about that. Also in the news, the Finnish Fire Safety Central Organization, or Suomen Pelastusalojen Keskusjärjestö, is organizing a Spend Your Day at the Fire Station Day. That sounds a bit weird, but anyway, they are organizing that once a year. And this year, due to the corona situation, they will be organizing that virtually. So that will be a AR or VR experience that will be revealed on November. So we are looking forward to seeing that. But that was all in the news today. And we all, Mr. Kalle 1, and is it 1? Yes, Kalle 1 and Kalle 3 would like to thank you for watching our newscast today. Have a good overnight, or if you are watching this outside of all, have a good night, morning, whatever. Toodaloos.
Okay, so that was that.
Quick question, Teemu.
Yes.
What does Lieke mean? The Punu Games mascot.
Nothing, like names normally, like Joe doesn't mean anything, so.
There you go.
There's nothing meaningful about that. It just sounds nice, I guess.
Fun name. Okay. Thank you for that.
Thank you. But I don't have anything to add to that. I think that was strange enough, so I think we can continue.
Well, thank you very much for the XR Nation Spatial News team for that informative segment. Some very top-notch editing going on there. Okay, so next up, we have a special presentation from Eero Salminen, who is the CTO and chief nerd of flyAR, Augmented Reality Studio. And he's going to be talking today about augmenting IoT. So we're looking forward to hearing that story.
Yeah. Let me just share my screen. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, sir.
That is awesome. I will start sharing. Is my slide visible? All good. Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm Eero Salminen, and I'm from flyAR, like Joe mentioned. This is our small company. Just a quick promo. We're doing custom AR experiences for all kinds of projects. If you're interested, send me a message. I'm on Slack. A short story about augmenting IoT. So this will be about AR and Internet of Things. And the story starts with Joe hearing about me knowing something about this stuff. And he asked me if I want to talk about this online or in the event. And I said, yes. I then started thinking that I actually don't know that much, but I like making demos. So that's where I went. I decided to make a demo and talk about that and all the thoughts that popped up in my head while making that demo. I had a lot of fun, and here I am. So first of all, just to make it clear, I am not an IoT expert. I am an AR guy. I'm just playing around with this stuff for fun at my home. And so if some of my development choices don't make sense, don't be confused. It's because I'm new to this thing. But I love learning, and that's why I took up this opportunity. A little bit about my setup. I'm not gonna go into the details with the technical stuff, but the AR will be spatial AR. So not picture tracking or this kind of stuff. I'll be having it in a space in this room, actually. And the IoT will be from the perspective of home automation, because that's somewhat familiar to me. So home automation is in the context of devices that you might have at home, smart lights and all that stuff. To make this work, I have a Raspberry Pi. This is my hardware. It hosts my software and a few sensors. The IoT software itself consists of OpenHaven, which is like a operating system packaged with all kinds of pre-configured stuff for this purpose. OpenHub, namely. In addition, I have Node-RED, and I'm using MQTT as a transfer protocol. You can look all this up if they are interesting to you, but basically Node-RED allows me to create logic in the back end, create like flows between IoT devices. OpenHub I use for finding my devices and defining them. And MQTT, like I said, is the protocol for transferring messages. And I picked these just because there's stuff that I'm interested in, not because they are better than others. There's a lot of options to do this stuff. They were just something that I had talked about with friends and family, and then I decided to try them out. For the AR, I'm using Unity to build a mobile app, and I'm using the Immersal SDK for spatial mapping and relocation of devices, or a device. And here's my beautiful little Raspberry Pi in its habitat. Okay, demo time. Or actually, it'll be three demos. I split it up because I had lots of weird ideas that are not necessarily related, and I thought it'd be more simple to show them one at a time. The first one is very simple. I'm just gonna have a button, and it's gonna do some IoT stuff. After that, there'll be something to have a two-way connection between AR and IoT, so sending messages both ways and having something with that. And then alarmingly advanced, something a bit more fun. Okay, this is my first demo. Now I have this screen on the way. I don't know if that was there the whole time. I'll put it full screen. You can see my beautiful setup with plastic plants and IoT stuff like everyone else. And there's a little AR panel there showing buttons. I'm going through them quickly to showcase what spatial AR is. It's right now showing basically a point cloud or feature cloud of things that I'm tracking to have content in the space. Works really well. Then there's a mesh button that showcases a byproduct of the process where we get a textured mesh and putting it on top of the real world looks kind of funky. Or my friends said it's scary, but yeah, that can be useful. And then there's actually the IoT button, which is called light, and it works. That's it. Basically, it's just a Hue Philips bulb that's connected to the same network as my Raspberry Pi, and I'm sending it a message to turn on. But it worked. It was fairly simple. I did not expect it to work like that. And if you were wondering, the buttons, the AR buttons on the panel, I'm tapping them on the phone. And here I got an idea while I was recording this that I should probably try if it works when I'm also using the Philips Hue app. And the video cut out quickly because there was a bug, so it's not working. Okay, we continue. Okay, so some thoughts on the first demo. I don't know why this doesn't go full screen, but let's just leave it there. The bug that I quickly mentioned was that I was simply sending commands from AR to IoT and disregarding everything else. So when there was a state change from somewhere else, I did not update the user interface, which just shows that this stuff is not, at least for me, it's not organic to think about all these asynchronous things happening in different like platforms. So a kind of a IoT mindset has to be built when you're working with these things. Those were some thoughts that I came up with. Let's look at the second demo. Same setup, but now we have still the light, but down there you can see there's some sensor readings, and these are from a, I had to show that I fixed the bug. Sensor readings, showcasing, data from a luminance sensor typed onto my Raspberry Pi, showing that the red values goes up when there's a red light. So this is what I meant with two-way connection. It's nothing groundbreaking, but now I know that it works both ways. There's also this weird distance button on the panel there, you might have noticed, and that's something I came up with when I was thinking, what could I use like in AR to do something that's like you cannot do normally with IoT stuff. So this one turns on the intensity of the lamp based on how close I go to the lamp. And that's because I can calculate the distance with the spatial stuff. And of course you could do this with any kind of distance sensors or motion sensors maybe. So I don't know if it's unique, but it's what I came up with while I was doing this. It's pretty nice actually. Okay, see my thoughts on this. Reading the data was easy. It was actually much harder to send the data. I had to do some Python scripting on the Raspberry Pi. Still something that developers could quite easily do if they wanted to try it out. Reading easy, presenting it nicely. That's a whole science thing. You could have nice graphs and stuff, but I'm not that good at it, so I left it at numbers. Then a big question is, what's the benefit there? Like this is a hard one for me because I've been thinking a lot about it. You could have a dashboard just on the app, and you could easily see lots of these numbers and stuff. What's the benefit of having it in AR? And I've been talking to quite many people. There's a lot of conflicting opinions. And I think it's simply something that needs to be tried out with different situations to find out if it's good. Like if you have a lot of data, maybe it's fine. If the data has spatial features or it's spatial in nature, maybe it's awesome. I think that needs some thinking about. yeah, the distance thing was cool, and I think that highlights that spatial related IoT connections might be something to look into more. Last demo. We're still in the same corner. Now there's a scary, I don't know if it's scary, there's a CCTV camera up there. And there's a few more buttons again on our panel. First one is occlusion. Some people are familiar with this, but it's basically trying to hide digital stuff behind physical things. So I can go around the corner and hide the digital stuff. You can see that it's not perfect because I'm a lazy developer. I was using the mesh that was generated as part of the mapping as the occlusion mesh. That means that there are holes and gaps. You could do this manually, or you could use another process to create a nice occlusion mesh to have it perfect, but this is what I went with. And then we have this security button. I have no idea what this is. Oh, we got caught. So now we have to hide, and this is again something I wanted to play with because it's kind of spatial in nature and slightly unique maybe for AR. Definitely would like to see a game with this. I can peek around and sneak around the camera. Hopefully it doesn't see me. Looks like I'm a good sneaky guy. I'm not sure. Well, that was that. I got caught, but it's fun. So in case you missed it in the last video, I was turning on all the lights in the room red when the camera saw me. And that gave a lot of immersion to this kind of experience. I think it could be used a lot with games and maybe some escape room kind of things, mixing all kinds of physical and digital effects. XR games are very cool in any way. So I think that's a way to go. Maybe it could also be used in some other use cases like Wi-Fi penetration kind of stuff. When you have a map of the location and the environment, you can do kinds of analysis maybe, or camera blind spots. Maybe you can fine tune your cameras to and visualize where they don't see this kind of stuff. I don't know. Environmental understanding here refers to using some kind of AI or other technologies to better understand the properties of the environment and then tying those into the experience. And I think that's something I would love to explore more. Okay, we did demos, or I did, and lots of thoughts. I think I learned that it's hard to find super clear use cases for AR in IoT, but a lot of spatial features could drive that section. We could have, like, navigation is fairly obvious. We can have navigation around in 3D and all these distance-based spatial data kind of stuff. And AR is, of course, kind of cool for user experiences when you can just point at your devices and configure them. Cool, useful, I don't know. But in any case, if you do AR in a location, you kind of enable all of this. So it becomes like, it becomes cool. Use cases, what I think, industry, kitchens, hospitals, games, my favorite. I think we should do more XR games. And I think that's everything. If anyone has any questions, now would be a great time to ask me.
Yeah, I have one.
Okay.
Are you interested in doing more demos and exploring what else you can, you know, what other kind of cool things that, you know, you discovered while doing these demos? Are you looking forward to doing more?
Definitely. I love the kind of interaction between physical and digital that you can create with this. And I would love to do more. I also hope that many other people try this out, like getting a Raspberry and all this stuff is fairly simple. And I don't think you need to be a developer master to try out this kind of things. It's a lot of fun. I recommend it.
And I have one more. What would the next demo be when you had the opportunity, when you have the opportunity to do one?
that's a hard one. Probably a larger space, and I don't know, it would be quite interesting to create some kind of adventure experience, like an escape room, but in a larger scale with physical stuff, speakers, lights, all kinds of devices, and then digital content. I think that would be great.
That sounds awesome. Definitely.
Next level. If anyone else has any other questions or stuff, feel free to send me an email or reach out in Slack. I'm in the XR Nation Slack as well. And yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Let's. Okay, so I'm not going to show any screens anymore, at least for now, because I've been having some issues with those. But the next presenter we have, just 1 second here. Okay. Yes, so the next presenter we have is coming to us all the way from Iceland. And she is the founder and chief meditation officer of Flow Meditation for Modern Life. And her name is Tristan Elizabeth Gribbin. And she'll be taking us through a guided meditation session and telling us more about Flow VR.
Yes, I'm here. And I don't know if I'm sharing my screen already. Am I already sharing my screen?
And
I'm a little bit chaotic here. Sorry about that. Okay, so first of all, thank you everybody who's here. This is so super exciting. I love this group. And thank you, Joe and Timo, for creating this amazing platform for us, the innovators and creators in this space. It's so fantastic to connect like this. Thank you for your presentation, Eero. I hope I said your name right. So cool. I want to share with you a little bit about Flow. We established the company in 2016 and with the vision to do something really cutting edge with meditation, because it felt like that there was a lot to be done. And just, you know, just a little, the problem we address is the stress. Now it's a global crisis, the stress epidemic we're all living in, people, so much change and so much, you know, mental stress that's happening. It's become exacerbated with, as we know, with the COVID. And so we really are here doing the right thing at the right time. And so what we've discovered with Flow since the beginning, and I was a skeptic coming from a meditation background, is that when you create highly effective meditations in VR, that people can have a profound experience of meditation from their very first try. Now, sometimes with meditation, with trainings, it can take weeks and months to actually feel like you've gotten somewhere. But when you really carefully craft the experience, and what we've done is we combine stunning, pure nature imagery shot in high resolution with really, we have award-winning filmmakers creating these natural, pure settings where people can escape from the busy life and go and have a session. So the other thing with Flow that's unique, besides transporting people out of stress into a world of wonder to where they can meditate. I mean, we know that, you know, it's been proven that VR, nature imagery in VR has a calming effect on the mind. So immediately, like the heart rate calms, the variable heart rate increases, and the mind, the thoughts become more regulated, and we can then meditate. So it's, you know, VR turns out to be a very powerful tool for meditation. So, but inside of our apps, we have not just one way to meditate, not just mindfulness, not just becoming, you know, aware of the breath and the sounds and the typical mindfulness meditation, which is in itself extremely valuable tool. We also have other tools for meditation, which I'm going to walk you through today. So this is going to be a fun experience for everybody who's on this, because we're going to meditate together, which I'm most excited about. So in flow, we have these six modes, starting with breath, which is the fundamental beginning foundation for most meditation practices, becoming aware of breath and increasing the breath. And then from there, we're going to do some gentle movement, and then we're going to let go or release, actively release some tension in the body or emotional tension, depending on what happens in the moment for each one of us. And then we're going to get from there, it's very natural to go to a deeper calm. And we'll have a moment of calm. And then from there, we're going to focus our minds on our intention, because this turns out to be the most powerful tool in meditation, is that when we're in that calm space where we feel connected, when we choose a focus and stay with it, it is very effective in attracting to us that positive energy that we're seeking in meditation. So whether that's, you know, whatever that positive energy it is you're seeking, maybe it's just energy. Or maybe it's you want to feel more calm. Maybe you want to feel a greater ability to focus, or you want to feel energized in order to be able to take action, or you want clarity. You want an answer to a question. Whatever you're seeking in meditation, when you focus your mind on it, that's when you you attract to yourself those solutions, those answers, and that special energy. And then the final mode of flow, and that's the focus part of meditation. The final mode of flow, as you see in these six circles, is restore. And that's sometimes my favorite one, because it's a full body relaxation. And when you relax, when you manage to have that deep moment of really relaxing every muscle of the body, you have your batteries get recharged, and you come back to your day full of energy. So this is what we provide at the workplace with flow. I haven't said so much about what we do. We're basically providing to companies meditation solutions. So we're in 40 companies in Iceland, from energy to banking to fashion to, you know, like just the most wide variety, even the government, training people how to meditate at work. So if you can imagine, you can, you know, put on a headset at work and be transported to nature and from there meditate. So let's just take a moment right now to actually take some deep breaths and imagine. You could close your eyes and imagine you're in your favorite nature setting, whether it's a beach that you're familiar with or a mountaintop or wherever it is you feel most connected to. You can close your eyes and take some deep breaths. And just let go of some tension of the day. On our next inhale, let's stretch our hands up to the sky and really fill the lungs with oxygen and energy. Stretching open the rib cage and really taking a deep breath in. On the exhale, you can bring your hands back down and release any tension you feel in your body. And just continue to breathe and feel connected. Thank you for taking that moment to meditate and breathe. That's really nice. So I've kind of given you a little background of what we do. We go into companies, we provide these tools. It's the VR headsets, the stands. This is our flagship product that people are so mesmerized by, they love it, is Flow VR. It's also available to consumers, but we have not been marketing it. But we were going to start doing that now that we're working on getting onto Quest. We've been on Oculus Go since the beginning. And, you know, we've had, I don't know, 1,000 downloads or something like that, just organic, not by promoting it, but just, you know, just being out there. But yeah, it's really we've been going for the corporate wellness market, but now we're going to be focusing more on the consumer market. COVID sort of did that for us, because when COVID happened, we our corporate sales leveled, and we needed to really turn towards the consumer market. So we're looking at that much more, and now we're on SideQuest. So anybody out there who has a Quest headset, please download Flow, and please write us a nice review. That would be so great. We would be so happy. And if you ping us, if you write us a thoughtful review and you ping us, you can win a prize. You could win a free subscription to Flow. And we would just be so happy to hear from you. So again, and then we are also developing the companion mobile app, so that we have audio guided meditations on our mobile app. And this will, our mobile apps will also have this 360 degree nature imagery, all kinds of beautiful shots. So telling you about Flow, that's our amazing team. We're very female led, as you can see, our CEO, CFO, and myself leading the charge. And but we have incredible award-winning filmmakers, and we have our CTO, who's a VR, and he's an expert, and then fantastic team. This is the final slide. If anybody of you out there know of an organization, a company that would be interested in our services, providing stress relief and bringing meditation to the workplace, which is boosting well-being, communication, bringing so many positive benefits. We have these wonderful corporate programs. But again, also, we're also just really happy to connect with you all on an individual basis, and just really happy to make the connection. So now I have a few more minutes. I don't have that many more minutes, but I wanted to take us through a guided meditation, some more guided. I just did a quick breathing thing, but I wanted to give you guys a little bit of a taste of the six modes of flow. So does that sound good to you? Just like a quick, I think I can have, 4 minutes to just guide us through guided meditation. Does that sound good? Okay, good. So what I'm gonna do is I am going to, and I'm still sharing my screen, but I'm gonna open up Spotify. I'm actually gonna use my iTunes, and I hope this is gonna work. We do have a Spotify channel for flow meditation music, but I use iTunes more, so that's more. But I'm gonna choose a 4 minute song, and then I'm gonna do a guided meditation. Sorry, this isn't a more smooth segue. You did a much smoother presentation, Eero. Much better planned. Okay, it's coming. Okay, so I have one of my favorite songs, and it's 6 minutes, but I'm gonna just choose this 4 minute song here. That's Jónsi. So we work with a lot of Icelandic artists, by the way. We have Sigur Rós and Jónsi and Ólafur Arnalds and Guskus, and we use music in our meditations, just so you know. And to me, music, makes meditation much more effective and helps me to go deep. So I'm gonna play a song for 4 minutes, and we're gonna go through some of these flow tools, okay? Starting with breathing. Does it sound okay? Yeah, okay, all right. So again, let's close our eyes and take a deep breath, and again, stretch our hands to the sky. Really filling the lungs, really expanding the breath in every direction, to the front, to the sides, and the back. Deep, full breath in. Breathe in some more, breathe in some more, and on the exhale, release. I just want you to keep breathing and gently stretch the body. Breathe and stretch. As we breathe and move our bodies, we're able to connect deeper within. Again, deep breath in, stretch open, open up the breath, Breathe in some more. Breathe in some more. On the exhale, you can shake out some tension in the body. Just shake your hands, shake your head back and forth. Imagine you're just releasing some stress from your body, some tension in your body. Shake it out. Now we're breathing and moving and letting go with movement and with our intention. And then we can imagine we're sitting at the edge of a cliff, and any tension we've been carrying around, any situations, any irritation, we're just throwing it off the cliff. Shaking the hands, shaking the head back and forth, and shaking off anything that's been holding us back. The next thing we're going to do to release tension, a deep release, is we're going to scream. So you can take a deep breath from the belly, and on the count of three, we're going to scream into our inner arm like this. I'll demonstrate. Okay, let's try that together. Deep breath from the belly. One, two, three, and. Whew. Screaming is a very healthy release, a great way to let go of stress and tension. Just shake out the shoulders, shake out anything you feel, any tension you feel in your body. Okay, and now we're gonna continue to breathe, and we're gonna calm down. We're gonna calm down the movement of our body. We're gonna become still. We're gonna calm down the emotions we feel. We're gonna calm our minds. And we're gonna take long, slow, deep breaths. With every long, slow, deep breath, feeling more calm and more deeply connected within. And as we come to the end of our meditation, let's end with a focus on gratitude. Gratitude for this moment, gratitude for being alive, gratitude for this community we're connected to, and gratitude for all the many blessings we have in our lives. It's always good to end meditation with gratitude. And I'm very grateful to all of you for meditating with me today. Thank you so much. Okay.
A fantastic experience. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Okay. So, does anyone have any questions for Tristan? We have some time for one or two questions.
What should I tell my girlfriend about the scream she heard?
Tell her you're learning to meditate. You know, it's like with flow meditation, you know. You can show it to her.
I'll do that. Thanks.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. Well, thanks again, Tristan. I think we all needed that.
Me too.
Okay, so next up, we have one of the torchbearers of not only the Finnish XR industry, but dare I say of the world XR industry as well, Varjo. And we have a vertical lead with Markus Heinonen with us. And he'll be giving us a demo and telling us more about the latest exciting news from Varjo. So please take it away.
All right. Thanks, Joe. And thanks for inviting us here. And thanks, Tristan, for the calming set for this presentation. So let's try to stay awake for the last part of this presentation here as well. Now that we are all full of positive energy, so I can share some positive news from Varjo's side. So we just yesterday I announced a big case study that we did with Kia Motors. This was a lot of work, a very long process. This started already 3 years ago when I first time visited at the Kia's design center in Frankfurt. And back then we only had the Oculus that was hacked with our displays inside of it to show the very early prototypes of our technology. And even then, they quickly realized that, okay, this is the tool that they need to be using for the future of their car design. Because what they said back then, that this was the first time that they could see the paint flakes in those virtual models. And of course, this is something that we would never think about as the creators of that technology, but users, for them, the most important things was to see those details, like the flakes on the painting. So ever since then, we have been now working very closely with Kia, and finally, we were able to announce this partnership that what we have been doing. And when they brought our technology also to mixed reality, so they're using the Autodesk VRED in their design processes. And now that this is the first true mixed reality device that's implemented in Autodesk VRED. And for Kia, this was extremely important, not just only because of the current situation that where we are in, nobody can travel, so you can't even visit the design centers. But even before that, they when they used to do any kind of design reviews, it took them 4 days to first they had to travel to Korea and then present the designs. And now they can do all of that in 1 hour in VR and also mixed reality. So here's a small clip of Kia in action. And I really like the last part, that they're actually using the Darth Vaders as their avatars in their global design meetings. But this is how it works in practice, that some people are joining with VR headsets, others are joining with the XR headsets, and they're all in that same physical space, so that it seems. And then they can interact with the virtual models and make modifications. And what they're also doing is they're comparing those virtual models side by side with the physical cars. So right now with the XR technology, they can look at their clay models and they can put the virtual car next to that, or they could overlay that clay model with the new model just virtually. So these are just some of the possibilities that you can now do with the XR headset. And one great thing of this technology as well, which is a very crucial part, is the reflections and shadows. So the virtual car is reflecting the real environment just like a real car would. So in that way, you don't even distinguish between what's real and what's not anymore. And that's exactly how the technology should be. It should be something that you don't really see anymore. It's just a natural extension of your work. And this is a great representation of that, the work that Kia is doing here. And then earlier we saw that clip from our office and the green room. So I thought that it would be interesting also to share some of the quicker demos and few examples how you could do that one yourself as well. So the green room is very interesting because right now you can make any VR scene into mixed reality experience by using that green room technology. So here's and it's really that simple to do. All you have to do is select the color that you want to use as the chroma key. And then everything that is that colored will be then shown as the virtual content. So in this way, you can use any existing VR content and transform that into a mixed reality experience. And one of our partners, Mekivial, have made a great demo of this. So you can look it up from YouTube. There's this Winter War XR experience with the Varjo. So you can see it after the presentation from there. What they did is that they added a real gunnery and then virtual scene around it. So this is the great thing about the chroma key. You can seamlessly integrate anything that is physical with the virtual world. And here's just a couple of other examples of what we have been testing at our green room. So you can have a home showings where you're in the same scene with your colleagues. You can have any kind of training experience where you're training with your colleagues, or you can use the eye tracking well, as you hear. And what this does is when you can see everyone else physically in that same virtual environment, it really transforms the whole experience. But I think that we are running out of time here. So I think this ends it for me as well. I just wanted to give the message that it's really that simple to do. All you need to do is press one button and you're in the different mixed reality environment. So thanks a lot.
Thank you, Markus. Does anyone have any questions for Markus at Varjo? I know that Demo earlier was talking about the project that you have, the partnership you have with Boeing about the astronaut training. Are we going to hear more about that as well in the future?
Yeah, definitely. And we have actually a upcoming webinar on that project and together with Boeing and Unreal. So you can sign up on our website to our newsletter, so then you will never miss any of the upcoming webinars that we have. So this will be in the upcoming next weeks that we will talk more about this project with Boeing, which is also extremely interesting. So those of you who haven't heard, that's the part when Boeing decided to start using our technology in their Starliner program. So they are training all of their astronauts nowadays in VR, and all the way from the early parts of the training to the whole space flight. So more about that coming in the future as well.
I don't know if it's a not a question, rather congratulations that you guys are doing awesome things. So I think a double thumbs up probably from everybody. So I know, does Tristan have a question? Or was it a thumbs up?
Yeah, I have a quick thought, just wanted to share. I got to visit your offices when we were at Slush last year, and I got to, with UC, and like, I got to go inside the demo, like see the reflection of the, you know, when you're looking at the car and you see your reflection in the reflect, it was so incredible. And then we got to visit a Japanese temple, and I was so overwhelmed by the experience. I actually sat on the ground and was like praying and meditated in the temple. And just so in so much admiration for what you guys are doing, bringing such a real, you know, experience to people. And I would love one day to create a meditation. We actually talked about it, you usually talked about it, like creating a meditation for inside the temple.
That will be, you know, awesome.
Hopefully one day we can achieve that. Thank you.
Okay, now I'm going to, thanks again, Markus, for sharing, it was fantastic. And I'm gonna try to share my screen again because it's time for to wrap up and for some announcements. And it doesn't want to. Okay, here we go. Nice. I just want to quickly just the announcements. Next All Night Helsinki will be in December, and we're planning something very cool for you all. It might even be a world first. We'll start sharing more as things progress with that. And I just want to thank all of you that have joined us today, taking the time. I know, for some of us, it's already getting dinner time and these kind of things. For all of those that are watching online, and for our participants, Eero from flyAR, and Tristan from Flow, and Markus from Varjo, and my partner in crime, Temu, for bringing us Spatial news. And once again, thank you to our wonderful sponsors, Adilin, Glue, and Grib, the movers and shakers here in Finland and in the region and in the world as well. Stay safe, and we'll see you at the next All Night Helsinki. Thanks again.